Welcome to Italian Folk Music Revival in Italy. Our first presenters will be Marie Di Cocco and Celeste Di Pietropaolo, who will talk on evolution and dissemination of Italian community music.
We are independent scholars and do not have musicologist credentials. I have master's degrees in mathematics, linguistics, and operations research. We also do part-time professional musicians and dancers who work to educate the public, especially Italian Americans, about traditional Italian music and dance, namely to break the stereotyping and misrepresentation that exists in this country of that culture. This is where our interests meet with Calandra. We suspect from learning about the discourse of being presented by the other panelists here that the title of this panel should really be Italian traditional music, revitalization in Italy. Traditional music and dance in Italy, for the most part, never died in the private familial occasions where it had been continually practiced for hundreds of years. So there's no need for a revival if you are speaking of traditional music. However, traditional music seemed to have been disappearing in public venues due to the exposure to modern life and its music, read American here, and the ubiquitous presence of folklore groups. The folklore group, although its origins are over 100 years old, was propagated everywhere during the fascist years as means of social control. The main activity of folklore is primarily one of entertainment. The main activity of tradition is primarily one of education. We are in the education business and not the entertainment business. Early folklorists and researchers were in the education business. Today, very few study organizations, mostly in the New World, still use the term folklore to describe their activities. In Italy, folklore has had the same original connotations for first and second generation musicologists, Nigra, Favara, Corso, Cocchiara, Pratella, et al. The third generation, post-World War I, Diego Carpatello, Roberto Leddi, and Pietro Sassu, et al., saw a greater emphasis on the terms tradizione and musicologi. Their students, Bruno Pianta, Placido Staro, Ettore Castagna, et al., fourth generation, have all but dropped the term folklore. When we teach, we always refer to these experts who refer to traditional tradizioni, musica popolare, balli popolari, balli antichi, etc. Although we are considered collectors and at best documenters of traditions, we are content to be participants in the process of educating Italian Americans. In 1984, we were sitting at a meeting in Somma Vesuviana and heard Roberto De Simone urging his students to suspend the analysis process of music traditions in favor of recording, before the traditional informants, linguistics term, had left us because he was afraid it would all disappear otherwise. As a result, we did just what he said and began recording, collecting, and learning as much as we could. As we showed last time when we gave a presentation in the next room in 2009, here are some distinctions between current meanings of folklore and tradition. Figure one. Folklore is passive, the audience-performer relationship. Tradition is active between participants. Folklore is authoritative, discreet, and static. Tradition is spontaneous, improvisatory, evolutionary, and forgiving. Folklore is exclusive regarding skill level and age group. Tradition is non-discriminatory. Folklore is unidirectional and preemptive. Tradition is communicative or conversational. Folklore is market driven. Tradition is community determined. When tourists or Italian Americans travel to Italy in search for folk music, American term, they are invariably directed to venues featuring pop music, ballo liscio, that's tangos, polkas, waltzes, and mazurkas, or at best, exhibitions for entertaining tourists, including Italian tourists. One way of classifying traditional music is the trichotomy of ritual, exhibitional, and social, and there's plenty of overlap. This is a general classification, and it's clear that to say that these three views often overlap. Ritual music is performed by individuals regularly in specific roles, places, and other specific contexts. Exhibitional music is used solely to communicate messages between participants. Social music is solely for the purposes of enjoying and sharing. DVD cut one. Here we have an example of the social, Mogidoro province of Bologna, singing in the piazza after an evening of traditional dance. And notice the finger gesture that you see here has an exhibitional function. It means pay attention. These are the correct words. Maria Guerlini is the master of carrier of the tradition, the older woman you see here. Can you see? So the next cut, we have an example of the ritual. Penna San Andrea, province of Teramo, seen as part of a questua ritual during the San Andonire festival. January 17th, La Veglia, so we did the 16th. Here's an example of the social and ritual at the Festa of the Madonna dei Pozzi in Aspromonte. Giovanni Schipiliti from Palmi is the sacristan of the santuario.
Okay, so from here we're going to talk about evolution or change. Change can be viewed as a result of motivation and the action of motivators, who we call changers. And we see that there are three types of changers, which is the bottom of that poster over there. Authority, for example, like a dance master, the leader of a performing group who tells the people in the group, this is how you sing, this is how you dance. You have the marketplace. For the example, an audience, the media, or some other entity for a specific type of gain. And the community, which is the social group that maintains the traditions being passed down and accepted generation by generation. Italy, having been occupied for many years, has had its music and dance influenced by foreign cultures. The Americans were influential in adaptation of the clarinet. There is music from the Naples area where the clarinet took over the role previously held by the ciaramella, which was a folk oboe. Dances from the Occitan are still prevalent in Piemonte. Ballo liscio, polkas, waltzes, mazurkas from Central Europe, and tangos composed by Italian immigrants in South America and their Italian variants are still interspersed with traditional dances at village dance events. Returning work migrants within Italy, Italian tourists and families from interregional marriages bring tunes and style changes over regional boundaries. Many songs are no longer sung in local dialects. Modern times, changing customs, media influences, and church influences in the South change contexts in which traditional music is practiced. And then there are the generational affected changes in gender roles. The younger generation often learns techniques from their peers, or YouTube today, in today's world, not necessarily local, from learning and playing traditional instruments. They may be learning from formal music schools dedicated to teaching the local instruments, but using typically a fixed repertoire doesn't always necessarily represent the local culture. An example of that is in Abruzzo in particular, you have schools that are teaching the dubotte, which is the little organetto. And they sponsor gadas all the time at the festivals with all these students sitting up there and they're all playing the Carnival of Venice or something like that. So it doesn't promote any sort of personal interpretation or techniques that they've learned traditionally from local masters. Reinforcing community characteristics by returning musicology students aids in strengthening public performance already known in private. So you do have, in today's world now, the fourth generation musicologists who work amongst themselves using methods that they've learned professionally in the schools in revitalizing traditional music and dance in their own communities. So we, as an example of that, we attended a workshop in the Toe of Calabria for the local, the dance down there, and we were so impressed that these local people in this little village knew how to present this dance in a way that made it easy to learn, could break it down, and it was just not something we had ever experienced from people like that. And it turns out that they had taken classes from Placido d'Estato, who's a well-known ethnomusicologist whose specialty is dance. And so they were taught how to do this, and then they could pass on their tradition to others. And there are numerous festivals today and workshops all over the country. It used to be it was trying to find a needle in a haystack if you wanted to try to find it. Now you have to find the right haystack because everybody and their brother goes and does a workshop one place and then comes back and decides they're an expert and knows how to present dance and music. In any case, to be considered traditional, a change must be validated or authenticated by the community. Otherwise, it's at best considered a temporary borrowing or a fad. To authenticate a tradition, one must answer the question of who, what, where, when, and why. This music is a permanent representation of the community of which it's considered a tradition. So we like to use the term local core when it comes to determining whether a dance really is from that community. And here we have some more DVD cuts. The first one is going to be an example of Ex Voto, accompanied with family musicians. This is at the Madonna di Vigianello in Pollino, which is on the border between Basilicata and Calabria. Traditional hymns and dialect used to be sung all night long during the Velia, and the best dancing in homage to the Madonna used to be right in front of the altar. And in the beginning of this, you see the Madonna dressed in a dress, and she has a sash on her, and the children will go up and they pin money on her. The pilgrims would come in throughout the day and swipe their handkerchiefs on the Madonna and wipe their kids' faces down. Then there's another part of it a little bit after that where there's a bagpiper coming in, which was some years later, and some men singing just right there. And if you can see, the Madonna no longer has the dress on. And there was a box next to her where people put money. Nowadays, she's actually enclosed in glass. So you see somewhat this evolution of what's happened, and people are no longer allowed to dance in the church. So you can kind of see a little bit from the side, she's not so approachable anymore, the Madonna. And if people try to dance in front of the Madonna, they're stopped. However, after Pranzo, in the field, they will dance. And the young man dancing in this is actually the sacristan who would stop people from dancing in church. You have to go to the next one. Okay, the next one is a festival in Villa Verde, which is the province of Oristano in Sardinia. And it was fascinating because there was a local accordionist that played music imitating the Launeddas. And they had hired an orchestra complete with a young woman in a miniskirt and white go-go boots who played accordion. And they had this whole show they put on. And the entire village sat around the outside of the piazza like this and stared. And the minute you had the pausa and the accordionist got up there, the entire village came out and danced for half an hour.
Can you? I don't see.
Just,
oh, yeah, I see it. Okay.
Just double click it. It'll play. Should.
Is it up? Yeah.
So here's, this is the accordion player, who's imitating the sound of the launed thus, which is the traditional instrument from Sardinia. And there's the people in the piazza, who previous to that had been staring.
Second part, dissemination, which we refer to as non-communal change. Here we take a cursory look at factors and stresses leading to change of the traditions outside of the community and in particularly the New World. The diaspora leads to music multicultural enclaves. Immigrants from same regions emigrated to neighborhoods reflecting the culture of their Italian communities. These neighborhoods provided economic cooperation and emotional support. Many smaller immigrant Italian communities were not large enough to support churches or social centers and recreation, and as a result, the musical practices became blended, or musical recreation came from classical or urban traditions. At any rate, traditional music renderings supported by communal environments began to disappear. Aware of the degree of assimilation required for social mobility, immigrant parents did not encourage to a significant degree the practice of traditional music. Peer pressure, especially for the children, aggravated that situation. Pop culture completely altered all but the main melodies of music brought by the immigrants. O Solo Mia became, there's no, what was the title?
Now or Never.
It's Now, thank you. I have There's No Tomorrow. It's Now or Never. La Sorella, according to my mother, became chewing gum. Cenaluna, obviously, as most of you know, became Lazy Mary, etc. Performing groups are susceptible and biased towards renditions that please audiences. There's the motivator. They also direct changes to their presentations in light of competition with other performing groups. Group psychology and added constraints leads to fewer participants from the Italian-American community. The feeling that one does not have the skill or is in the wrong age group negates the purposes for participation in traditional music and dance. In addition, because many of the Italian-American folklore groups are composed of younger people, often children, the music and dance that they learn is associated forever with childhood. So as soon as they mature, they turn their backs on it. Borrowing, whether unconsciously or deliberate, from other ethnic groups, borrowing occurs from other ethnic groups, more than infrequently in the development of performing group repertoire. Center-periphery model was developed for economists to describe the attempt to explain the structural relationship between the advanced metropolitan center and the less developed peripheral societies. It says that the underdevelopment concept is not a result of tradition, but is produced as part of the process necessary for the development of capitalism and its reproduction on a world scale. Read globalization. According to proponents of the center-periphery model, and bear with me, the appearance that capitalism is developing traditional and backward societies by locating enterprises in underdeveloped regions masks the cultural relationship by which capital develops and prospers at the expense of non-capitalist economies, written by economists for economists. Translate that to traditional music. So you substitute folklore for capitalism or enterprises, substitute villages or communities for underdeveloped societies, we get the following. According to proponents of the center-periphery model, the appearance that folklore is developing traditional and backwards villages by locating folk groups in villages masks the structural relationship by which tradition develops and prospers at the expense of village traditions. An example from linguistics. Just one more moment, minute. Linguistics. For many years, Afro-American English was thought to be a backward, undeveloped form of American English. This masks the reality that it is considerably more complex, robust, and nuanced than standard American English. We have reviewed the necessary conditions, not exhaustive, to redirect these misrepresentations of our cultural equity brought about by simplifications and non-community adoptions. I'm quoting here straight from the Association for Cultural Equity. Ellen Lomax maintained that folklorists and anthropologists could not ethically stand by while the world's cultural variety was grayed out by standardization, economies of scale, and powerful entertainment industries. 30 seconds. Lomax called on folklorists with their specialist training to help those they studied to safeguard their cultural practices, self-representation on their own terms. He also stressed the responsibility of educators to ensure that children learn about oral traditions of their families or localities.
Celeste and Marie have been documenting village music and dance in all 20 regions of Italy since 1983. They credit their understanding of traditional music and dance to studying with Italian ethnomusicologists, especially Placido Estarro, and to long conversations with Alan Lomax. They have worked part-time as a professional musician for 50 years and have taught traditional Italian dances since 1983 in 26 states and 50 cities. Okay.
You talked about the groups of children kind of, you know, pro forma learning some of the traditional instruments, but that kind of music teaching is done in many countries where children, you know, hordes of children are taught the violin or taught whatever. Now, while we might see it as negative, all it takes is one incredible talent to come out of that, yeah, right? And
that's
to help
true.
Promote
that's
it. Do you
true.
Have any experience
well, yeah,
of that? Or
we're talking about the excesses here in America. And
well,
the
no,
problem is,
in Italy too.
Well, some yeah. in Italy too, but mostly here because we're familiar with other cultures, European cultures. And when you see a kids just don't, there's no joy in what they do when they're performing. And also, you know, once they graduate, there's exceptions. There's some Greek communities, they still dance their Greek dances. But I've seen Polish groups and German groups, you know. It's,
I mean, it's not always, the exceptional musician does not always come from a family of musicians. But typically, the ones that we've found and have met did learn from the elders in the community more so than in a school. Although there is a fair amount of that going on in different places. I mean, and I think a lot of it really depends on the focus of the school. So in the province of Bologna, in the town of Monghidoro, for example, they have the Piccola Scuola di Musica, but it's run by an ethnomusicologist. And the goal is to learn the music of their town and their area. And so the children are taught in a traditional way. They're not taught to read music and play some repertoire that has nothing to do with them. They're taught the way it would have been passed down from parent to child historically. And so as a result, they're learning in a more traditional way than going to a formal like music school where, I mean, in Abruzzo, the Carnival of Venice and that kind of music is not Abruzzese, and they're not teaching these kids to play the saltarello from their village. They're learning this fixed repertoire that they say this is organetto music.